Flip time.
Hello. Hello, everybody. Welcome to another episode of Lumpia with a Vengeance Q&A series right here on Kumu.
Kumu.
Yeah.
Good
evening. Happy Monday to all. And if you're joining us here in the U.S., that's right. Good evening. And if you're visiting from the Philippines, good morning, everybody. We right here are the cast and crew, you know, behind the talented, awesome, award-winning feature film, Lumpia with a Vengeance. And my name is James Von Tayau. I play Philbert, but you know what? It's not just about me. It's about the amazing artist I'm about to introduce to you today. That is Gerald Pillare!
Shucks.
What's up?
Shucks, dude. Hey, man, how's it going?
Happy
Monday.
Happy Monday, brother. We did it. We're starting off strong.
Dude, I don't know. Mondays suck for me. So.
Yeah. Well,
yeah.
We'll make it better. We'll make it better with this conversation.
Yes, we will.
Yeah.
Yes, we will.
I got to get it right out of the way. We grew up kind of in the same area.
You're like
Daly City, San Francisco.
Yes.
So it's good to talk to another hometown hero.
That's right. I know, right? 415. Yeah.
Forever.
So Daly City was 415 for decades. And then 20 years ago, they switched it to 650. So I'm a 415 Daly City.
Yeah.
God, I'm old now.
I just
aged myself, didn't I? Yeah.
No, so, you're wise. That was like a big deal when they changed the area code,
right?
Like anything, you know, it's like, I remember three phone numbers now because you don't remember anything.
Yeah.
Right. And like one of them is my old house number, which doesn't exist.
Oh.
And my old, my best friend's neighbor, like who's neighbor, his number doesn't exist. And my own number. So if I'm in an emergency, I'm out of luck.
You can't go back. There's
Not
no
yet.
Going back, man.
Yeah. But maybe will be. Yeah.
it's like a Twilight Zone episode now. Like your homecoming is just like nothing's the same. Everything is like changed. And this used to be here.
Yeah.
What happened?
That was there. You know, did you watch the reboot of Twilight Zone?
No. No,
yeah.
I honestly, it's been a hectic spring ever since April. So
yeah,
I missed out. I barely got to watch WandaVision. So
you did.
At least I fit that in, but yeah. I didn't even get a chance to watch. What is it? Falcon and the Winter Soldier. I have to catch up now. Oh God.
No, it's okay. I think you know. You have a great excuse. You've been busy. You've been working.
Yeah.
You know, and the good thing about that is that you have time, like all these streaming services,
right?
You know, you have been bringing it back to, you have time to
right.
read a book, throwing back to the Twilight Zone episode of the guy.
Yeah,
there's so much out there, but you know what? I just want to congratulate you and congratulate me and congratulate us because
yes.
we're part of an award-winning film, man.
There you go,
we
man.
Did it.
Yeah. There you
Check
go.
That off the list.
Yeah. Oh, wait. Here we go. Here's a, yeah. I don't know if this will show. It's too much. There, winner.
That there. Sexy Ooh. Hollow. Is it hollow foil? What would you call
hollow
it?
Foil. Yeah.
Ooh.
Winner.
I get those sweet 90s comic book vibes all over.
I know, right?
That is awesome.
Thank you, sir. I mean, Ooh. Honestly, thanks to everybody involved on the project.
Mm-hmm.
It's been a roller coaster ride. Everybody's been wondering forever. You know, honestly, we've been asked, I think, almost every week, where are we going to catch the movie? You know?
Oh,
And then Hawaii happened and, you know, oh yeah, you can log in. And then, all of a sudden, oh, I'm so sorry. We sold out. And so a lot of people were bummed that they didn't catch it.
Yeah.
And here we are. Was it chapter two? Back home, a homecoming festival. So,
oh yeah,
yeah,
it's right around the corner.
Yes.
May 14th.
May 14th. Yes, I think that's the premiere. That's the start of the premiere weekend for CAM for us for Lumpia. So
yeah,
yeah.
I really, I'm really excited about it. It's nice. It'd be nice return to CAM. I haven't been to one of the events in a long time, but and I know we're in good company there.
Yeah, so
that's going to be awesome.
Yeah, look, it looks like we're sharing the billing with some heavy hitters, man. And boy, good. Well, let's just like say that let the spotlight shine bright on us anyway. I think we've earned it. We've worked hard for it, so you know, we know what we've got. We know what we made. So, but also, I just actually been meaning to ask, like, when did you catch the movie for the first time? Did Pat get a chance to show it to you? And
yeah, I luckily watched the Hawaii.
Okay.
Screening, so I jumped in that early. That was it was amazing. Isn't to watch with a little bit of family.
Yeah,
my family up north didn't get a chance to watch it because they ran into the same issue. But they're so excited for May. But I definitely it was like nerve wracking to watch, you know, because it was, I don't know, it's like a weird, you know, it's I don't know how it is as an artist, as I mean, you know, both artists, but you put something down and it becomes a comic book. Right. Is it weird for you to be like, yes?
Yeah, you know, because it is. As you, like you rightfully said, we're both artists, you know, you're a performing artist, I'm a visual artist. And when you're shown on the screen, or you put product down on a piece of paper, or now digitally, and you're judged, you know, and the harshest critic is yourself. And then when you see other people put eyes on it, you're like, oh God, cross your fingers, you know, like it's that nerve-wracking experience, because, you know, you're an artist because of the passion you have for creating art. But that also sets you up for art critics. So it's always going to be a double-edged sword. But, you know, mostly, I've never heard anything negative. I mean, everything's been really, really positive. And I am really over the moon with the positive response by the fans. Even by, like, so the cool thing was, we had a meet and greet earlier last year, December, before the big lockdown. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we didn't know what to expect. Lawrence Iriarte, who...
shout out to Lawrence.
Yes. Shout out to Lawrence, who's a machine. I don't know what he brought up, man. I really don't know. I don't know if it's Bang Energy and coffee, or Red Bull and 5 Hour.
All the above.
Yeah,
it's probably warrior a spirit. Cocktail.
Yeah, but he's the one that masterminded that, and Jeffrey Fragancio, who actually hopped on for the comic book, also decided to come in and meet up with us. And me and Jeff have never done a meet and greet like this, and you know, we're flying by the seat of our pants, and Lawrence is like, "Don't worry, man, just take it easy, relax." And I don't know if I could do it, Lawrence.
Like, no, you did that right, because I got relaxed when you said that. I'm like, you're right, Lawrence.
Yeah, you know, all right. You know, and then, man, it was so insane. I think from the first moment we set foot into the comic shop, shout out to Green Machine Comics.
Ooh, that's at New Park.
I gotta, you know, represent them too, because if it wasn't for them, we wouldn't have had this great turnout. It was a great turnout. Once we stepped into their floor, I mean, it was nonstop. Once we stopped setting up, we had people coming in.
Oh, so cool.
People coming. Yeah, it was awesome, man. I was like, what's happening today? You know, some people were just picking up their subscriptions from the shop. And, you know,
that's great.
And then, a lot of them bought Lumpia, man. You know, it was awesome. And everybody was positive about it. So, yeah. It was
so cool.
Yeah,
I can't wait to get my copies, and mostly just like very selfishly get them signed by everybody, you know. And like, that's did you had a chance to watch the movie?
Yes. Yeah. I did watch it for the hit for Hawaii International Film Festival also. And I was like, you, man, like, gosh, I mean, I was watching with family also, but it's still nerve wracking. Work we poured into it. And you know, I remember watching the rough cut, and
same. Yeah.
And oh, I don't know how you felt, but I, you know, being also associate producer for the film and pulling the major work for the art that's in the film for the art production, it was a wake up call, because it was the rough cut really showed how far behind I was.
Oh yeah.
So,
So explain a little
yeah.
bit, Mac. Like, what did you really do? Like, how did you contribute to that in
Oh
as far as,
man.
yeah.
So there are vignettes. So pretty much like scenes are cut in a way where characters are introduced in the film, and there's a still shot, and it's done in artwork by me. And if you notice
Cool.
how many characters are in film, there's a lot of
A
still
lot.
shots. And it wasn't easy. Alone, Pat had the idea of doing some scenes that introduced the movie through panel work, and that's also produced by me. So it was
Yeah.
a lot of work to undertake.
I can see the
Yeah.
scenes down in my head. I'm like, oh yeah, there's a lot of those.
And yeah, honestly, like when I saw the rough cut, I was like, oh my. Like, of course, there's like something that's in place of the still. And I'm like, oh, I gotta do that one too. And then I gotta do that one too. I was like, damn, how many is that? I stopped counting, man. I didn't want to freak out and say, oh, I'm so far behind right now. But when I saw the fight and how everything was put together, I felt proud. I felt relieved.
Yeah.
It was awesome. I gotta say, it was great to see everything finally put together, you know? Yeah.
I
And
felt the same way,
speaking
man.
of,
Same
yeah,
way. Like it was like I felt like sad and happy, and like sadness was like I wasn't able there to enjoy it with you guys, with everybody out there, in a theater. And then I was like, a lot of it was like surprise because I don't remember any of this stuff. And when it comes together in this cohesive, lovely story, it's
Yeah.
such a surprise that you're like, oh my God, this worked. Awesome. I'm so glad. And then I'm not just talking about me, I'm talking about everything else. And I
Right.
just can't wait to celebrate this with everyone at once. You know, that's what I'm looking forward to the most this year.
Right. I mean, and that's
Yeah.
the cool thing. Like, you're coming into this film. You signed on to this project, and you were cast as a major character in this film.
Yeah.
I don't know how much I can spoil. I don't really want to spoil
Yeah.
anything, but okay,
Yeah.
we'll just say that, of course, you play the character Filbert. Okay,
Yeah.
so of course, in the original movie, he's a close friend of the other main characters. And I just wanted to ask, like, how it felt to step into the role of Filbert.
Yeah, you know, one of the best, and I'm trying to like not spoil anything, but one of the best experiences I had was there's a scene with all the friends. And I was able to really just kind of talk to everyone. I pick and choose moments where I was able to just like walk up to somebody, one of the actors, and
Right.
just talk a little bit. And it felt like, you know, I was like, oh, this is like hanging out with like friends.
Yeah.
And I was able to talk a little bit with Francis for before a scene, and we just kind of just talked about high school, and we talked about our friends, and like that kind of made me feel that like I was part of the group, but I'm removed.
Yeah, right.
But it was, you know, it made me think about my friends from high school. It made me think about like, you know, those people you grew up with and helped form your early teens,
Yeah,
and how much of a
true.
different person you are now. And it kind of made me sad. I'm like, oh, should
Yeah.
call those people. I should get on
I
Facebook.
know
Yeah.
it's funny too, because like we said, shout out to Francis Castudio, who's also one of the main characters in this
So
film.
good.
And he carries in from of course the original movie.
Yeah.
And you guys are best friends in the original movie, at least the characters are.
Yeah.
So even though is and that's the funny part, like he was one of the people, the cast that you connected with quickly, and is our best friend in the film. And it's interesting because, like, I think you fooled another cast member, because I think another cast member thought that you were the original friend from the first movie. And I think it's Ed Baon.
Oh
Shout
yeah.
out to Ed.
Ed was great.
Yeah.
So good.
And I think Ed came up to you and he told me this story. He came up to you and he was like, hey, what's up, man? And he thought you were the other actor because, you know, they were all from the neighborhood and he thought you were him. Now, was that serendipitous where like you were so good at being cast as Philbert that even people from the neighborhood thought you were Philbert?
Yeah. Well, when I watched, I rewatched the Lumpia, I think it was when they did the Kickstarter run and, or not Kickstarter run, like when they just, the anniversary, I think it was 2013, 2014. I'm not too sure on the dates, but I watched it. And even then I was watching, I was like, that guy looks like me. I look like him. Am I him? And I was there by myself. People are like, why are you asking me? But yeah, I have a college friend who messaged me recently and was just, I haven't talked to this person in a while. And they're like, hey, are you in Lumpia with a Vengeance? And I looked you up on IMDb and you're playing Philbert? I'm like, yeah, you should watch it in May. And he had so many questions. I was like, all these questions will be answered during the premiere. but it's cool to someone that like knew the movie ins and outs and asked specific questions. And I was like, very, very, very good. You're going to love this movie. So, so I am Philbert.
Yes, you are. Yes.
Here's like a, it's like a weird question, right? And I know you drew me. Is it hard to draw someone you don't, I mean, you knew me from thing. Is it hard? Is it weird?
It is weird. You know, this is the thing, you know, with I think anybody who draws, once you draw good and people notice you draw good, people always ask, can you draw people? Like, that's like almost the second question, man. Like, can you draw like her? Or can you, like, of course, if it's like a pretty girl or a family, like an auntie, there's always an auntie out there that like, can you draw
me with bigger breasts? Yeah. Like, I don't want to do that.
Make me look glamorous. What glamour, you know? But yeah, you know, it kind of is a challenge because you want creative freedom to kind of create your own worlds and characters and machines. I love cars, so I like designing cars on my free time when I'm doodling. So when every time somebody asks me, can you draw me or can you draw him or her? It's tough because I don't want to say I don't want to, because in all honesty,
you don't.
I'm sorry, guys. Like, I'm like, okay. You know, but it's just ironic that no matter how hard I try, you know, I always wind up I have to get the likeness down, and it is tough. It is weird. It's weird, yeah. Man. Yeah. And honestly, the easiest guy to draw. I can't say Francis. Actually, Francis is interesting to draw because, you know, he does have a signature facial features and stuff. Mm. And he carries Mon Mon so well that you could kind of get the gist of Mon Mon.
That's great. You know? Yeah.
But I would say it's actually Mark, the Silent Avenger, Mr. Lumpia Man himself, because when you think of a hero, you think of big guy, you know, imposing. Looks like he can like just carry himself. Mm-hmm. So you could kind of caricaturize Mark because you're already thinking of the hero physique. So all you got to do is just don't make his face too off. And then you got Lumpia Man. So
that's cool.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Dang. And so you mentioned a little bit about, you like to draw cars. You like to draw, I mean, it's weird to ask an artist like what your style would be.
Right.
But I saw that you draw some, like, you drew, browsing your Instagram page, and you cars are awesome that you draw.
Thank you.
So, like, the Initial D car, I was like, nice.
Oh, thank you, man. Initial D, yeah. See, you know. Yes. See, now we're going to start geeking out now.
Yeah. I went to Comic-Con for the first time a couple years ago, and they had the car there. I was like, oh,
what?
Can I get in this? They're like, no, I'm not good in this. Yeah.
Had the Japanese script too, the Fujiwara tofu delivery vehicle.
Yeah, it was cool. I used to rent all those animes from in Japantown.
Yes.
VHS.
Yes.
Ah, so good.
Yes. So good. Man, we could go off on tangents all we want too, man, but we don't have enough time.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. Damn. See, gosh. Where were we at?
You know, I just want to say the holofoil cover is by far one of my favorites that you drew.
Thank you.
You drew a lot of them, right?
I drew two.
Okay. That's a lot. That's more than one.
Yeah.
So nice.
Yeah, it was, so that's a cool thing. Like, I think this one is, I might as well pop it up again since I already have it here.
Yeah.
So, you know, I mean, Earl is cool. I love drawing Earl.
Everyone there.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Yeah.
But you know, this is where you could take liberties because now they're characters and you get to kind of play a little bit with what they would be in the comic book world. So yeah. That was like a fun thing to do. And then of course, like I had to put Mun Mun in the side of it just to.
The inspiration for that was an X-Men cover, correct?
Yes. Yeah. Yep. And that's the crazy part about this whole thing too. Like, you know, when you grew up during the 80s and 90s and you're collecting comic books and then you're like finding your way, you're forging friendships with people in high school and, you know, you're bonding and all of a sudden you see this whole world of X-Men and the comic book art is just mind blowing. And it made me want to be, drawing for them. And I found out like who these artists were and I was like, whoa, these guys are, oh man, I want to be them. And then, you know, you start collecting Jim Lee, which is, you know, what the cover is paying tribute to. And then of course you start realizing that Jim Lee and of course, Will Sportaccio, worked in the same studio in homage studios. And I was like, no way. And then you're like, Wills is Filipino. Oh, that means I can do this too. You know? And
yeah. Oh, it's so cool. So those were the guys for you.
Yeah. And so those were my inspirations. Those were my motivation to keep going, you know, you know, when you're growing up and parents want to like ask, what do you want to do when you grow up? Back then, comic book artist wasn't like feasible, you know, like why? Like comic book, why? You know, it's not like, why not the nurse or doctor or, you know, something safe, you know, or something predictable.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, I suck at math. So if I get a dosage wrong, you know, that's on me. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, but if I put a fancy line down on a piece of paper, there's a chance that people will like remember who did that. And that kind of like just it spoke volumes to me, you know, especially in high school when these guys were like inspiring all the stuff that I was doing. And then, you know, I get in touch with Patricio, Mr. Janelsa himself, director at large for our project here. You know, he signed me on. I signed on to do the film. And then he goes, I might get Wills to do something. And when he said that, I was like, what do you need me for? I was like, you got Wills, man. He was like, you know, but this is the cool thing about Pat is like, of course, Pat is also one of the kings of geeks that we work with, but he appreciated, you know, the work that I was doing because we went to the same high school. And so he saw me do all this stuff. He saw the artwork I was like dishing out in high school and wanting to like, see if he could like work with me someday. And so that was the crazy part, you know, now we're working together on this thing. We're like doing these Lumpia comics and stuff. And then, you know, he's got Wills with him. And I'm like, what? It's like mind blowing. Like the circle that It's like it feels complete, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh man, I gotta go back home to get all my comics. This conversation makes me want to revisit all my comics. I mean, Jim Lee definitely is one that I started reading comics because I saw those. And
yeah,
so like same thing when someone told me like, oh, Willis is Filipino. I'm like, really? Well, then I'll get Wetworks number one. Yeah. Oh God, so much good things. Mm. So much good things. So many, a great collection of artists and talent that Pat put together that I just feel so blessed and so, I mean, honored to be part of this. And every time like this, it keeps going. Like there's issue number 2 is coming out and you know, we have a premiere and it's a gift that keeps on giving. And I'm excited for people to watch this and
And the cool thing is too, is like I said, like we're, so after the May 14th premiere, we are scheduled to do another meet and greet on the 15th. So there's another chance. There's another chance for everything. Yeah. So yeah, man. You know, it's gonna be. Oh, man, I can't wait to have some fun. Seriously,
it's gonna be great. You
know? Yeah,
man.
Yep.
Oh my God, I didn't know that. So that's a great weekend for all Olympia fans and lovers alike. So
yeah, I know, right? And comic book fans. And speaking of comic book fans, and I know we're bouncing in and out, but I don't care because you know this is how geeks do.
Fun, yeah, it's this fun. Is what we do.
Yes. So like I talked earlier about Jeffrey, and man, this guy, you know, I'm glad that when we did the first issue, we got all these artists to contribute. It was a blast, you know. And Jeffrey was like Jeffrey Fulgencio, the Fulgen Show on Instagram.
Follow him.
He is like going insane with his technique right now. So he has produced a new holofoil for issue 2.
Whoa.
Yeah, and it reminds me of God, it reminds me a lot. I know he might have said something with his last show with Justin Kizon, but it reminds me of all those epic 80s posters where you have the man, you know. Okay,
yeah.
So since it's a comedy, we're gonna stick to comedy. So you know how you had Star Wars and you had Luke and Leia like in the poster,
posed.
And then like a beam is coming through. Like through the rest of the paper or poster, right? And since it's a comedy, okay, the one poster it reminded me of the most was National Lampoon's Vacation.
I saw this. Yep, I thought the same thing.
Yes.
Yeah.
We need a side by side. I think somebody maybe on social media we got to do side by side of Jeffrey's.
Put them together.
Yes, of Jeffrey's cover and Chevy Chase. And then,
what a great cover though. When I saw it, I was blown away. I was
And like Jeffrey is going out of his mind with his technique, man. He's like, his output is mind blowing right now. And I'm like, dude, slow down, man.
When you see other artists going hard on Instagram, because it's so accessible to see other people's progression or like what they're doing. Yeah. Is it inspiring and, or is it like maddening? You're like, hey man, leave some for us. All
right, dude, it's intimidating, man, you know.
Yeah.
But that's I think that's the great thing about especially like Instagram and social media and those online portfolio sites that actually help you develop into a better creator, let alone artist, if you want to pursue professionally into the art field, no matter what it is. Just the variety and the perspective of different people, like I mean, I get blown away by some of the young guys. I get blown away by, you know, Jim Lee and Will still. And knowing that you got this gigantic pool of reference and it's so accessible. It's insane. Like we had to wait monthly or every 2 weeks, remember, to get the next issue of X-Men or whatever it was, Battle Chasers, Wildcats, Wetworks. We had to wait, you know, and now it's like, there's the option of it's just like streaming, like you said, where, you know, I have time now to stream the Falcon and Winter Soldier. And
almost you are correct, Captain.
But yeah, I mean, it's insane, like the resources available,
yeah,
and how easy it is to tap into that now. Yeah,
it's scary, but it's also exciting, you know, because you can just reach out, and if I have a question, or I'm like, man, let me just ask this person. Like, I watched someone's short film recently, and it was on Amazon Prime, and I was wondering, it was like a real nerdy question, right? It was like a scene that was at a table. And I was like, oh, how did this shot work with all the actors in this way? And I literally just DM'd this director and was like, hey, nerdy question. And they were like, yeah, man, this is what I did. I'm like, oh, thanks for asking. And I realized that was a real crazy question. But it's, I mean, hey, I'll put it out there. And then I was like, I should have asked him, can I work with you?
It's like your fanboy geek self like wanted to know like his approach, but like you forgot to say, I admire your work and let me know if there's anything.
Yeah, right. How do you do that? It's like I come across a lot of directors I meet, because I'm in LA and a lot of times I'm like, oh, hey, I'll be like, I really enjoyed the episode you directed of this episode. I'm like, oh, thank you. And we'll chat and leave. I'm like, how do I say it? Well, I'd like to audition for you. Or how do I say I'm too late now?
Right, right. Like,
yeah.
Yeah. You're like walking away. That was fun. Oh, it's like you forgot your phone or your keys. Like, damn it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, it's always in the back of your mind, but it's not coming out of your mouth.
You know what I mean? it's so fun to be able to like admire so much that's happening right now, since you know during the pandemic, so much streaming content is coming out, and you've been amazing at not watching all this content and like putting in the work. No, it's like a compliment. Like, you put in the work, you're doing the work, and I think that's something that we got to be mindful of, right? Of like, all right, well, stay the course.
Yeah.
Do what you got to do, and then when you can celebrate or treat yourself, watch something. You know?
Right. When I achieve. When I've earned the downtime, let's just say like when I've earned the downtime.
Yeah.
You're right, man. But I mean, let's talk about like you said, when you had these missed opportunities of maybe getting into the minds of these producers and directors that you run into or have asked questions.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I know you maybe missed opportunities there, but let's talk about the opportunities that you did have as an actor. Like, what was your first major break, you would say, or one of your first like moments where you said, this is me, like, I'm an actor now?
Oh, wow. Oh, that's a good question, man. You know, that comes up every time I do a part. Every time I get cast in something, I'm like, oh yeah, I did it. There was a moment on the set of Lumpia, which is like another thing of like, it's always weird to be like, because it feels like so long ago, and it wasn't, but it was. Because
you know
the process.
Yes.
There's a scene, you know, I don't know if I want to ruin it, but there's a scene I was talking to Mr. Daria. Yeah.
Okay. Yes.
Bosco. And I did this scene, and I was like, I looked at him afterwards after we cut. Pat said cut. I was like, oh, this is crazy, huh? And he was like, yeah. Stay in it. No, he didn't say that, but he was just like, yeah, man.
Right?
Yeah, keep going. I was like, oh, yeah. My bad. You're an actor.
Yeah, right? It's just too cool, right? Like,
so cool. He was so cool. I mean, the best Detective Bayani.
Right.
There's so many moments like that. And I'm just going to mention my favorite moments in Lumpia. Someone who made me laugh, not even on the screen, but off. And everyone can agree. Mr. Joey Gila.
Oh, so God, funny, man.
As Mayor Ronaldo.
Himself. Yes, Mayor Ronaldo.
We had so much fun off camera that he made it such a joy to like just hang out. And I hope everyone is blessed to laugh through him and from him and at him, not in that mean way, but in a good way.
Yes.
Yeah.
If you miss Joey, he's a regular on Instagram, and he, you cannot miss a post. You cannot miss a post from Mr. Joey Gila.
So good.
Especially when he starts those filters, man. You gotta watch. Yeah, turn up the volume and sit back, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's always nice to be reminded, though, you know, as like, I do, since I'm in LA, I get a lot of, since we're still in the COVID time, I get a lot of self-tape auditions.
Okay.
And so that's basically taping myself, sending out to whomever, the universe. That's what it feels like I'm doing, just sending it out. But it's always nice and a humbling feeling when you're like, well, I did that, next. And it's like that thing of like, I put in the work, now I can enjoy something.
Right.
Sometimes it's confusing things. One time it'll be a comedy, then it'll be like a really sad horror film. Then you're like, okay, well, got to reset the brain and watch some Rick and Morty.
Boy.
You know?
you gotta kind of decompress somehow, right? Like,
yeah,
you can't be like, yeah.
You gotta do it.
So like you asked me about like, you know, especially like the influences that I had as far as like an artist, a comic book artist, but like, you know, how you have your idols, like I had Wills and Jim Lee. Who would be your Wills or Jim Lee as far as like who you followed as an actor?
Yeah, it would be Bruce Lee and Jim Carrey.
Right?
Those are the two.
Yes.
You know, those are the two I looked up and looked at as inspiration. You know, Bruce for the, not just the obvious, right?
Right.
You know,
yeah,
the most sexiest, manliest Asian man, but for the mind, the mindset, and of his who he was as an artist. And then Jim Carrey, just because the physicality and the ability to contort and be, but also like as a dramatic actor, you know, I'm a firm believer, if you can do comedy,
right,
you can do drama. And Bruce definitely, like, you know, going into the acting game, like I went to theater school. I did stand-up comedy. I did improv. But I knew I can't just be good at one. I need to be good at all of them. Because I don't know who's going to hire me. Right. I may want to be on this TV show, but I might be in this cop drama.
Right.
You know, I might, you know, luckily I got the same time I filmed Lumpia. I filmed another feature film as this like 90s rom-com best friend who doesn't get the girl.
So
that's what you kind of like expect as an actor, different roles. But again, I'm thankful enough to like have good inspirations and like people like Bruce and Jim Carrey, but there's a lot more, but those are the big ones, you know, and probably a lot more cartoons than I should admit, you know, like where I'm like, or TV shows as well. So
I'm in that same boat too, man. Like, you know, if it wasn't for comic books, it would be Saturday morning cartoons, which doesn't really exist anymore, or Robotech.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the good thing about YouTube.
Mm-hmm.
People will put on 5, 4, 3 hour blocks of Saturday morning cartoons, and you can pick the year. You can pick this. Like I put on 1998 Saturday morning cartoons. Then it goes into like 1989. Mm-hmm. So that helps me not only to like feel like I'm nerding out
right
in the back, but it also gives me that essence of like home, that nostalgia feel, because it has the commercials as well.
Yeah.
Which is great.
Yeah.
And that really like helps me to like, oh, I remember this cartoon. Like, oh, I'm like, oh, I remember this. And it'll be Transformers or, and it'll go to a commercial. I'm like, oh, maybe I do want some corn pops. Did those still exist? You're like,
I remember like Slip and Slide, you know?
Yeah. Can I do this as an adult?
Like, yeah. Right. Like, can I get that? Can I go on Amazon and order that right now?
It's so easy to like, look up your past, your childhood, and be like, ordered.
Yeah, right. And done. Relive childhood.
I know.
Yeah.
I did that recently with a couple of Transformers that I had and lost. And like, I didn't want like the full like Dinobots Transformers.
Yeah,
I was missing a few. So I just ordered them on eBay because they were like,
completed your collection?
Yeah. So, like, but they're not complete. They're like, stickers are missing and like the limbs are all like loose. But I'm like, I don't care. I got them all.
No, exactly. I mean, and then the thing is, it's like, you know, there was another kid like me that really played with these toys. Like,
right.
Yeah.
I never let them sit. They were like used.
Yeah. Like, you're not afraid to like drop them or like, oh, the joint's too loose now. You know, like, no, this was a toy that was played with.
Loved.
There's a history with another kid like me that really, really loved this toy, to play with it over and over and over again. You know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I when I got those, there's a couple of figurines I got like that too. But when I have, I still have a couple other Transformers, and I, it's like those collectibles I really cherish because like I played with them, and like when I got them used, I'm like, you're so right. Some other kid did the same thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, and that's like important, you know, not everything can be just pristine.
Yeah.
And like a collectible, but I don't know.
You it's got it. It's with you now, you know?
Yeah.
Dude, you make me want to, oh man, I want to hunt down Sideswipe.
Oh, it's too easy, by the way. You're going to find, your phone's going to know, and you'll be like, it's here.
I know, right?
Yeah.
I was, that was like my, I mean, come on, it was the 80s. It was like, I think everybody had a, every dude had a poster of a Lamborghini in their wall at some point. And that was, of course, that was my favorite car to draw at the time. I remember drawing that when I was in like fourth, fifth grade. And when Transformers came out, I was like, what? He's a robot? You know, like, oh my God. I mean, he had a brother, like the yellow Lambo, but he was less cool. Because, you know, it was all about that red Lambo.
That red.
Man. Yeah. Yep. Oh,
heck
man.
Yeah.
Do I want to log in? And I don't want to. No.
It's going to, yeah. That's a weird, it's a rabbit hole we might go.
It is a rabbit hole, man. I'm tempted. I get tempted. You know, there'd be periods where I'm like, God, I love Gen 1 Transformers. Oh, man, Sideswipe. You know, just like.
Yeah. They're out there. They're out there.
I know. And I might do what you did. I don't care if it's honestly, I don't care if it's missing a wheel. I make model kits, and I could just order like a model kit wheel and just, you know, retrofit it somehow. You know, I don't care.
Modify.
I just want to know that this can actually turn into the robot, you know?
Oh.
Yeah.
You know,
right?
We're nerding out so much, man. Let's go into the nerd out. Let's nerd out around right now. Let's do
nerd
it.
Nerd out.
Wanna do it? So let's go. Favorite comic book character. That's a hard one for you, right?
Oh, hell yeah.
That So I'm sure you just can't choose one.
You know what? I'll choose one. I'll choose one. Wolverine.
Yeah, yeah. I agree.
Yeah.
Mine would be Spider-Man, but
Wolverine. That would be number two.
Yeah.
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 I know you mentioned not really watching anything right now, but like what have you binged in the last year or so?
You know, it's not complete, but I actually do like Stranger Things.
No,
Yeah.
It has all the great things we love, the nostalgia factor.
Yes. And it's set in our generation. It's the 80s.
You know,
it's got that Spielberg vibe. So
fantastic acting.
Yeah. I mean, man, except for that season two where they dressed up as the Ghostbusters. And I don't remember anybody that had that costume. You know what I mean?
Oh, no, like, yeah.
Yeah, come on. Nobody had the art.
No one can afford that. No one was that creative in the neighborhood.
Yeah, the proton pack. I mean, that's today's cosplay. I mean, come on now, Duffer Brothers. That's just way too elaborate for a tweener. Come on, man.
But it was cool to see.
Hawkins, yeah.
You know what I watched? I watched last during the pandemic was me and my partner, we watched Star Trek The Next Generation. And it was like my second time watching it.
Yeah.
But watching it fully through, yeah, it was like such an experience. It was beautiful.
How many seasons was that?
7 or 8?
It was a lot. It was a lot, yeah.
Yeah.
And then they would get those cameos.
Yeah, from a bunch of people. Man. It's just space drama, you know?
Right.
It's great. Picard, you know, Xavier, great. here's a question. I it's hard to answer because I don't know if it changes for you, but it's hard to say what's number one, but favorite movie of all time?
Ooh, boy.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a good one.
It's a tough one. I feel like that's like, well, we drink. And then.
Yeah, I know, right? Shot. It's a shot time. I would have to say Empire Strikes Back.
Oh.
Yeah. You know, I mean, I would say Star Wars because, of course, nothing was like Star Wars as far as like, you know, you had a freaking symphony doing the orchestra, the background music for a sci-fi fantasy film. And it just kind of like brought everything home, let alone the world that George Lucas built. But man, when you watched Empire Strikes Back and they're not even together, you know, you got Luke in another planet.
Separate,
and, you know. But just the character building in Empire was just insane. And then, of course, you know, if nobody has seen Empire yet, the spoiler in the end, where Luke finds out who his real daddy is. So, I mean, it just had everything, you know, like, it's impossible, you know. I mean, yeah.
I got to rewatch this movie now. It's been a while.
I wonder where you can watch it.
Yeah. If only.
Yeah, how accessible is Empire right now? Can I?
As I stare at my VHS collection, I can see it right there. My favorite movie of all time, I'm going to say it just because it's, if I was on a desert island, it would give me comfort. It would be Goonies.
Oh, that's just a classic.
Just because it would make me feel good.
It has a bunch of oddball kids on a quest.
Yeah. So good.
Yeah.
So fun.
Yes. That is a good one. Yeah. Oh, man. Honestly, I remember the score from that movie too. And that's the thing with me, is it's funny. Like my wife and kids, they're like, when I work on stuff sometimes, when I'm on the computer or drawing on paper.
I know where you're going. Movie soundtracks.
Yes.
I do the same.
It's not even the theme song music. Like, you know how you get like an artist to do a song for the film? No, it's the orchestrated soundtrack, man. It's literally the symphonic arranged music that fills in the background. So when you have those key moments in the film, the trumpets or the drums start coming up, and then, you know, you hear the strings and the horns because it's getting more tense. That's what I listen to. And they're like, what the hell are you listening to? And I was on a Hans Zimmer trip one time.
Ooh.
Like, yeah, because I was drawing something dark. It wasn't Batman. I was just drawing something dark. I can't even remember what it was. I mean, it could have been Wolverine, because, you know, Wolverine's history is kind of like
just
really
impaling people.
Tragic. Yeah, but it's a tragic story, right? So I was like, what's good moody music? You know, and I was like, I was thinking maybe I could put Muse or Depeche Mode or The Smiths.
You have great taste in music. I like it.
Man, thank you. Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm flattered, sir. But no, I pick Hans Zimmer.
Yeah.
I picked the Dark Knight soundtrack. So I was off and running, man. Yeah.
I'm currently puppy proofing my place because I'm going to get a puppy soon.
What?
And,
congrats. So
it's been a really fun experience. Like, I don't have a dog yet, but I'm going to get one.
Yes.
And I put on soundtracks, and I put on the Lord of the Rings soundtrack, and it makes everyday tasks feel like adventures.
Yes.
And I started at 10 a.m. and next thing I knew, it was 2 p.m. And I was like, I guess I'm done, but I still have the ring. What do I do?
Right. Because the song came
the
on. The part...
It's
the
so
quest
good to
is
do.
Not over yet, song.
Mr. Frodo.
See,
right,
and that's the thing.
Good
with,
idea.
Yeah, see, that's the thing with those orchestrated soundtracks. Is like, if you remember where that song came on in the film, you could relive it. You could almost like reenact it in your mind or out loud, if you know, if you feel bold. And then you're like, you're off and going, man. But yeah.
Yeah, it's those moments that kind of conjure up like whatever like piece of music comes and makes you think about that, like, oh yeah.
You know,
it's like I look at certain things, like, do you have anything like autographed that you own that really like you're like, yep, that moment, and it led to this, and that's why I love it.
Oh,
do you have anything like that?
Hell yeah. And it's funny because it's because of the comic books. I have signed copies. I mean, signed copies. They're not copies. I have signed comic books of the Omidge Studio guys. I have Jim Wells, Scott Williams. I have them sign my X-Men and X-Factor comic books.
Ooh.
And if it wasn't for them, I mean, it was cool too. I mean, you know, it's WonderCon when we had WonderCon up in the Bay Area.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, and
that's where I got mine signed too.
Yeah, and so it was those moments where it's like, I got to be part of this world. I have to be part of this world in some shape or form. And in an odd way, we are part of this world now. But I have another switch for you too, is because I heard from a little birdie named Pat that you love another superstar comic book collector and their films. And I think it goes by the last name Smith. So...
Oh.
I don't know if you want to add some detail into that.
Oh, yeah. So that's, I have Mr. Kevin Smith, definitely one of my favorites and influential moments when I first watched Clerks.
Yes.
I went to an all boys high school, and we had this like comedy through the ages class, which is like we watched Blazing Saddles, we watched Frankenstein,
right?
We watched all the greats. And then the teacher at the time was like a priest in training. I don't know what they're called, but he's like, I've got this from my friend. It came out at Sundance, and I was like, just put the tape in. Stop talking.
I know, right?
And it was this black and white movie called Clerks, and from the get go, I was like, oh, you can say this stuff,
right?
To
yes.
each other.
Yes.
You can film this.
Yeah.
they're not even moving the camera. We can do this.
Do Berserker. Do Berserker, man. Do Berserker.
And you know, that really put me on that path of you know, like, oh, like this is a different kind of voice. This is a different, this is a real, like, you know, besides all the fun nerd things in there, the Star Trek talk, Star Trek, Star Wars. Whoa.
Yeah, right. Yeah, yeah.
Just flash forward to, I went to go see him do, you know, his one person shows. And I was in line in the Glendale Brand Theater. And so we're there for the second screening. And then like, I sit like they're like, oh, here's a person of color. Sit him in the front. And I'm like, yeah.
Wow.
So I'm sitting in the front. And then, like, we're waiting. And all of a sudden the stage manager comes out. They're like, Kevin Smith isn't feeling well. He'll, unfortunately, we'll refund, but we'll get back to you guys. And so we're outside and someone's like, oh, man, I hope you didn't have a heart attack. And so I went home, had tacos, and I woke up in the morning and I was like, oh, Kevin Smith had a heart attack. I was like, oh, shit, did he die? And he didn't die. But that was like one of those moments. I was like, oh, man, I got to see him now. I got to see him. So
you don't know how many times you'll have left to see one of your idols. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I think it changed him for the better. He definitely looks slimmer and trimmer and a little more healthy. So,
yeah, I know. It literally woke him up. Like,
yeah,
not taking care of himself.
No, but
yeah,
exciting.
I remember I was already I think I was following him soon after that. And it was like, he was just getting such bad press about his weight. And
Yeah.
And then he flipped it and he's just like, well, why am I complaining when I could do something about myself? And then he totally did.
And it's amazing.
Like, yeah, now we got him, and I think he's like more prolific now, not as far as filmmaking, but as far as like what he's doing around the industry. Like,
yeah, I mean,
oh, he's busy.
He-Man's coming out.
Yeah.
And it's cool. It's cool to follow, like, you know, heroes and see them do well and like sustainability.
Yes.
You know, and like, it's one of those things where like, I knew of Pat. I'm going back to Pat, because I knew of Pat, met Pat, worked with Pat, and Pat's still going. And so it's like, yeah, man, that's what you do. You keep going at it and you keep crushing it. And I think that's something that's like, it's admirable. And like, I'm so glad that like, now I know you, and like, it's just fun to like connect. And like, I feel like we've known each other, but you know, now we do. So it's
now, so fun. Man. Dude, we got to geek out in person when we get the first chance to do it. Cause like, I think we're going to like, probably like talk shop until the sun comes up.
It's going to be great. I feel like we'll have you, and out of nowhere, Lawrence will pop up. Cause
he'll
be like, huh? I'm in.
Yeah. Yeah. Did you say something about Freck Miller? And then, he's just like,
I'm like, how did you get here?
What the heck? And then, you know, all of a sudden I see Jeffrey with his iPad, like, oh, hey guys, he's like in the corner already there. And like,
he's like, I've already drawn 3 issues.
I know, man. Dude, honestly, yeah, we gotta get the team together.
Yeah, we gotta do it.
We gotta do it. I know. Oh, man.
So fun.
This is not enough time.
No, it's not. But it's just a teaser, and I'm glad to know folks out there watching, hanging out.
Yes.
I hope you're enjoying it as much as we are, because this is such a pleasure, man. It's so fun.
Yes.
You know, it's so fun that, you know what? Let's keep the fun. Let's take it off at a high note. Let's do the comic book reveal. Hmm. Let's do it. Yeah. Oh, dude. What? This is awesome.
Thank you. Thank you. Oh, man. I can't wait to
So exciting.
I can't wait.
Congrats. What's it like, mean? Like, I know what it means, but
you know, because you have the facing cover with the title, just like any other magazine or book. You see it, and it has the title or the image, you know, and it's just the front. What the wraparound is front and back is the complete image. So it's pretty much double the work, which is hard, man. You know, especially what me and Pat had in mind for it. So it was a lot. And I was like, how can I spin this? How can I make this thing like lumpia? Like, there's hero covers that do this. I think we took inspiration from like Marvel Comics. There's also Civil War. I think Civil War might have done it, but it's cool because you get almost like a poster feel and you have the comic book already. So it's like a twofer, you know, because
yeah,
you know, a comic book is like this narrow, and then you open the back with it, and now you got the full image. So that was cool. That was fun, man. Honestly. Yeah.
That was so dope. I can't wait to see it, like, and hold it. And I gotta thank you, because you drew my character. So
yes.
I made it.
You made it, man.
I did it.
You are Philbert.
I did it. Oh, it's so exciting, man. There's so many great variants. There's so many. I love the fact that this exists. You know, yeah. Continuing the stories and filling in different things in comic book form is such a comic book like reader, lover, collector's dream.
Yeah.
And so to do that, I mean, to read it and to like talk to you and you explain to me what this is, and it's so fun, man.
Yeah. Damn. And now you're there. You're on the cover. So
but so many good things have happened this year. I'm a comic book cover. I get a dog. Movie comes out.
There you go, man. But okay, so like we're talking about this here. So what's next? I mean, yeah. you just touched on May 14th, and now you know May 15th. So
yeah,
what's next, man?
Well, yeah, what is next, right? Well, besides being a new dog owner, I'm definitely gonna be hopefully hanging out and nerding with you and the rest of the artists, man. That's gonna be so fun. And I'm definitely gonna keep enjoying what Marvel's putting out. I just finished Captain America and Winter Soldier, and I can't wait for Loki. So I'm just going to keep consuming all the stuff.
Right. Yeah. You know what? Speaking of Loki, that was interesting casting, right? You got Owen Wilson.
Yeah. Wow.
Right.
Yeah. So good. Yeah. I love the fact that they're putting everyone in there. You have Seinfeld. You have so many, like, you've got so many like great casting that like, why would you say no to that? You got to get in this, you know? I love it.
Right. Man. Ah.
Right?
Yes.
Like thinking about it, I'm like, oh.
Man.
How about you? Do you have anything? What's in the horizon for you?
Oh, well.
Ask me.
I am currently freelancing. So I'm actually finishing up a project, and let alone the comic book. So, you know, those are a lot of things on my plate right now, but afterwards I'm actually going to be focusing on some of my own artwork for a while.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
And maybe catching up on Falcon and Winter Soldier and all the other films I forget to binge, or shows that I forget to binge. But I'm going to buckle down and update everything for myself and keep creating. So everybody stay posted. Yeah.
Right on.
Yeah, man.
Well, you know what, you guys, this wraps up the episode of our Q&A chats. Thank you guys out there, everyone, for joining us, because I had so much fun, you know?
Yeah.
And thank you to Kumu. Kumu, you guys have been great to us, supporting us, and pre-orders for issue 2, including Jeffrey's, including all the other ones, which features, you know, my characters on there. Buy them up. Buy the copies, and tickets are still on sale right now for the San Francisco drive-in premiere of Lumpia with a Vengeance. It's a double feature with the premiere of the fabulous Filipino brothers. That sounds good to say. And it's directed by the one and only Dante Bosco. Yeah. So tickets are running out, but you know, don't be on Filipino time. Don't do that.
Yes.
Just buy them now.
Just because you're watching Filipino movie doesn't mean it starts on Filipino time. Okay. They have a schedule. And speaking of schedules, So we are doing another meet and greet at Green Machine Comics on May 15th. Everybody, I hope you guys can make it. New Park Mall, May 15th, mark your calendar. It's going to be the day after the premiere. So remember, no Filipino time on either day, please. Show up, have fun, hang out, you know, have a good time like we just did tonight. I hope we made your Monday a fun one, at least the night, at least Monday night. I don't know how your day went, but Monday night hopefully was fun.
Yes. And everyone out there, come back next Monday when we're going to do from the cast and crew. So thank you. A pleasure.
Awesome, man. So, but thank you.
Thank you, guys. See you later.
Yeah, we're going to geek out. You know, you're not seeing it, but I'm doing the running man in the chair.
I can feel it.
Yeah.
Kamusta kababayan ko? Oh my sexy Pinoys tonight.
This is our
No! Hold on! Nobody messes with my family!
You're my hero!
No, man!
It's too Filipino!
What? For real?
American!
Kamusta kababayan ko? All my sexy Pinoys and Pinays.
Welcome to Fogtown, where over 60% of the population is Filipino.
Can you confirm that the restaurant incident is the work of the so-called taquito man?
What?
This is the taquito everyone is talking about?
It's not a taquito.
It's lumpia, the Filipino egg roll.
The motives of the lumpia man are still unknown.
Lumpia Man knows we're selling out Fogtown High.
What did I tell you about these kids?
Love that.
Lumpia!
And love that.
Lumpia!
And love
your sniper took down the mayor as planned.
My henchmen are trained to be 100% efficient.
Is that the egg roll man?
Nah, it ain't him.
Go, 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 go! Hey, hey, you can't eat that.
Remember me? You're my hero!
Now's not the time to change the plan.
What plan?
What the?
Please tell me you're a good guy.
It's too Filipino!
It's like soy sauce and salsa.
Getting nuts.
All merged together in harmony!
Screw your mama's wedding.
Fight the bully!
You're all wrong!
It's all because of this damn Lumpia man.
It took this long for me to find you. I'm not about to lose you, baby. You can be sure I love you forever.
No more! Fogtown will remember me! Taquito boy!